Chihuahua.
Good afternoon. Welcome to our chapel service for Spirit Week. I've decided to go with the same theme that the Guardians chose, be the lion, partly because it's a good theme, because it's connected to the logo of the school, the lion, which is the symbol of St. Mark, after whom our chapel of St. Mark is named, and partly because the lion is the king of the jungle, and so encourages us to think about God's promise that the spirit he gives us is a spirit of courage and a spirit of power. But first, a warning. This is a Father Tim chapel service, so it's going to go the distance. Strap yourself in, and we'll begin as we always do, by remembering where we are and what we're about. We meet together in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. God of all blessings, through your Holy Spirit, you have given us not a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and love and self-control. Help us to have the courage to use that spirit, the courage to chip away until we find our true selves, like a sculpture hidden in a block of stone. Give us the bravery to be who you have made us to be, people who rejoice to love and to be loved. We discover who we really are in the loving of others. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lion King is a very famous movie, I can't believe that you've never seen it. I saw it countless times because my daughter was just the right age to be captivated by it. And so night after night for what seemed like a year and a half, I used to watch this movie with her when she got back from daycare or when she got back from her first years in school. She loved it. It is the story, of course, of a young lion who follows in the footsteps of his dad here, Mufasa. This young lion is called Simba, being held up here at his kind of naming ceremony or his baptism, while his dad and his mum look on. For a children's movie, it doesn't take very long for it to go a bit dark. This is the villain of the piece, Scar, Simba's uncle, Mufasa's brother, who's eaten out with jealousy and wants to be king himself. He hatches a plot to do away with the king, Mufasa, and to do it in such a way that Simba feels it's his fault. So he comes and tricks Simba into putting himself in danger during a stampede of wildebeests. Here he is in a limb, trying to stay out of the way of the stampede. Scar knows only too well that Mufasa, his dad, is brave and will think of nothing to try to save his son. And so Mufasa appears and tries to rescue Simba from the stampeding herd of wildebeests, but it all comes a little bit unstuck. And Mufasa is killed soon after the stampede in a way that makes Simba blame himself. Appalled at what he's done and scared of Scar, his uncle, he flees away from his land and goes as far away as possible through the desert, through the bones, the valley of bones, until he gets to another part of the world altogether. And there he's befriended by two pretty strange creatures who are curious about him and where he's come from, and to ask him what he's done.
Something terrible, but I don't want to talk about it.
Good, we don't want to hear about it.
Come on, Timon. Anything we can do?
Not unless you can change the past.
You know, kid, in times like this, my buddy Timon here says you gotta put your behind in your past.
No.
I mean,
amateur. Lie down before you hurt yourself. It's you gotta put your past behind you. Look, kid, bad things happen, and you can't do anything about it, right?
Right.
Wrong! When the world turns its back on you, you turn your back on the world.
Well, that's not what I was taught.
Simba makes good friends with these two characters, and having escaped from his past and all the obligations of who he is and who he's called to be, he has a whale of a time there in the jungle, hanging out with Pumbaa and singing the most memorable song perhaps in any Disney movie ever, Hakuna Matata, and just generally having a great time. And he does that for years and years until he grows from a cub into a full-grown lion. Here they are, horsing around and having the time of their lives. He's almost forgotten who he is. And so things remain until Rafiki, the god person, the shaman, the slightly crazy and unhinged figure, school chaplain, if you like, of the tribe, has a vision in which he sees that Simba is still alive, and he decides that he's going to set out to find him. And so he journeys out from the pride lands into the jungle, where he finds the grown-up Simba. And there he encourages Simba to try to return to who he is, to look inside himself, to find out what he's called to be. So after telling him to be quiet, shh, which seems to be something all school chaplains are called to do, because he's on holy ground, he invites Simba to come down to the sacred pool and to look in the reflection.
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No.
Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Encouraged by the vision of his father, to reclaim a sense of who he really is, Simba stops running from his past and goes back to confront it. He has a big battle with Scar in which he defeats him in the end, finds the lioness that he loves, and reclaims his place as the king or the leader of the tribe in the Pride Lands.
Loved by Nala, supported by Timon and Pumbaa, his new friends, whom he brings into his future along with a new sense of the value of his past, and guided and annoyed in equal measure by Rafiki, Simba finally takes his place in the circle of life.
Is The Lion King just a Hollywood blockbuster designed to make as much money as possible? Or is there in this movie, buried somewhere, something about the truth of the journey each one of us has to walk as we discover who we are, as we confront our past and learn through our mistakes about the kind of people we're called to be? Let's hear some wise words about this from our bishop, Bishop Garry.
Hello, everybody. I'm recording this at home because I'm locked down and probably just the same as you. I hope things are going okay for you during this current version of COVID lockdowns. Painting you can see in the background is of a station called Warrawong in the North Flinders Ranges, in a place called the Gammons. It's really dry and sparse, very different from green, wet and cold Ballarat. Anyway, this is Spirit Week, and I hope you're able to enjoy this series of talks and prayers and a little bit of music. I understand that the guardians have picked up the imagery of the lion in the school crest and have said that the theme for Spirit Week should be the lion and don't be afraid. So I want to tell you a little story about a lion. I don't know if it's true or not, but it's said that in Italy, when Michelangelo was at the height of his carving, a little boy went into his studio one day and saw the man knocking at the big piece of marble with his hammer and with his mallet and chisel. And he went back day after day and watched with amazement as gradually out of the marble emerged a beautiful lion. And he went back a week after, and it was almost finished. He ran home and he said to his dad, "Daddy, Daddy, how does that man know? How does he know that there's a lion hidden in the marble?" In a sense, it's not a bad little parable for everybody's life. We spend most of our lives trying to discover the lion hidden inside. What is it that's of our essence? What is it that's strong and proud and beautiful? How has God created us? And how do we discover what we're meant to be? I suppose there are really three ways of dealing with discovering the lion in the marble. One way is to say, it's all just too hard, I'm not going to bother, and I'm just going to let my life run its course. The problem with that is that you end up being a victim of other people and other circumstances. And particularly during this COVID time, it's really easy to be passive and just think, oh, well, I can't do anything. But in fact, it's not really a good way to live your life. Letting circumstances knock away and seeing what can be found inside. The second way you might react is to resist any attempt to discover what it is that is the essence of you. And sometimes we get caught up, particularly during the teenage years, but also later in life too, with trying to fulfill other people's expectations and resisting the reality of who we are because we want to be something else. And one of the great discoveries of adulthood is that we have to discover the reality of who we are and to own that. And that starts, of course, at exactly the time of life that you are all in, when you're working out what are the limits and the excitements and the ranges of capacities that make up the real you. And that leads us to the third way of responding to this question of how do we discover the lion in the marble, and that is by embracing everything that comes our way and expecting things to change and to grow, for bits to be knocked off, for polishing to take place, so that in the end at the end of our lives, we might see that the wonderful person that we've become is exactly the person God means us to be. That, of course, means we need to be prepared to embrace change, to look forward to difficulties, to recognise that often the most important growths in our lives in terms of our personalities happen out of difficulty as well as out of great joy and exaltation. It's not always easy to embrace challenges, and certainly this year has been a year full of challenges for everybody involved in education. It's been a year of challenges for us in the church as well. And I hope that in this Spirit Week, as you reflect on who you are and who God calls you to be, that you'll be prepared not just to be a passive, a recipient of change, and not just somebody who resists change, but somebody who embraces every moment that comes your way and so gradually uncovers the reality of the person God calls you to be. The other thing I want to say as well as don't be afraid of change or don't be afraid of difficulties as they come along is that the whole business about being a Christian is all about love. And in my life, the greatest antidote to fear is love. Love of your family, love of your friends, love of in particular individuals. And that great love we have sometimes when we feel overwhelmed by the beauty of the earth and by the capacity of the human heart to embrace so many good and wonderful things. So in this Spirit Week, I hope you'll be challenged to be the lion and to let that lion emerge from your life so that you can be a real agent of love and not somebody who's cowed in fear, but somebody who is open to the world and who opens your heart to embrace everything that comes your way. The God whom we Christians worship is the God of love, a God who in Jesus shows us that perfect love casts out fear. May you know that love this Spirit Week and always. Thanks for listening. Bye-bye.
And now we come to our prayers. In a normal chapel service, you remember, we have students rostered on from each house to lead us in our prayers. But I thought we might turn that on our heads today. And so I've asked a number of staff to say prayers for you. For prayers in the challenge that you currently face, for prayers in your schoolwork, prayers for your life with your family, with your friends, and for all the great things that happen in school that don't happen inside the classroom. So be still and listen and hold in your heart your family and your friends, your teachers, members of your church group, people you hang around with at school. Remember them to God as we listen to these prayers for you and for all the school.
Loving God, we pray for your presence with us as we again struggle through the pressures of learning from home. Give us a spirit of courage to make sensible choices in self-regulating our learning behaviours. Help us to be brave enough to keep open lines of communication with each other so that teachers can best help their students and students can communicate honestly about how they're tracking. Give us the wisdom to treat ourselves gently when teaching and learning become stressful and to turn to each other and to you when times are particularly tough. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Loving God, we pray for courage in our relationships, especially with those we share a home. Guide us to love our families, to care for them, challenge them, and work with them. Remind us that love should be patient and kind. Teach us that love should not be envious, arrogant, boastful, or rude. Embolden us to be grateful, giving, and forgiving as we share our lives and spaces. We pray for all in our community who are caring for vulnerable or ill family members. Strengthen them in their caring. Uplift them when they are struggling. We pray for all in our community who have family far away. Hold them in your hands until we can be reunited once more. Gracious God, we offer up to you our daily living and give thanks for our many blessings.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the blessing of friendship. You're the best friend one could have, and I pray that you teach us here in the grammar community to be better in this area. Lord, I pray for our students. I pray that you help them to be brave in their friendships. Give them the courage they need to care for their friends, to know when someone is in need, to be patient, kind, and forgiving even when it's hard. I pray that you help them to be brave in reaching out to others and starting new friendships with those around them. Despite living in times when it's easy to feel lonely and separated, I pray that the friendships within our community grow, that they remain strong and filled with joy, laughter, compassion, and love. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Dear Lord, we thank you for our tute groups, homerooms, sports teams, music ensembles, and interest groups. Thank you for like-minded people who bring us joy, encourage us, and give us strength. Thank you for members who we can work with to support each other to reach a common goal. Thank you for those who are different from us, those who challenge us and test us, but help us grow stronger. We remember now all these people in our teams and groups. We ask you, Lord, to fill them with a spirit of courage, particularly when they need it most.
And finally, a chance for you to say a prayer for yourself. Everyone's afraid of something. Scarlett Johansson is afraid of birds. Nicole Kidman's afraid of butterflies. Billy Bob Thornton is afraid of antique furniture. And Matt Damon is afraid of snakes. Everyone's afraid of something. What are you afraid of? What's stopping you from being the person you really are? What's stopping you from taking the brave step, the unpopular step, the scary step, into becoming more the person that God's made you to be? Let's listen to an anthem sung by our chamber choir. Teach Me is the name of it. It's from a psalm. In this case, teach me to be brave enough to be myself. And while we're listening to that, there's some space there for you to say a prayer about the thing you're afraid of, the thing you need to confront, to become who you really are, to emerge from the block of stone, be the person that you truly are. two quick notices before the blessing. If you're looking for more stories of courage and bravery, the Paralympics started yesterday. If you'd like to see more stories of people struggling to be the person they're called to be, people who have been brave enough to take steps out of their comfort zone to achieve real excellence, tune into the Paralympics sometime over the next 2 weeks. Learn some of those athlete stories. Secondly, some of you have come dressed up for chapel today. I can't see it, but you're going to take photos and I hope I'll see some of them. And in those photos, I hope I'll see not only that school spirit, but also something about the people that you feel you really are, something about the individuality that sets you apart, that makes you the unique person God's made you to be. Send me some of those photos. God give you the courage to look inside yourself to discover who you are. God make you brave enough to take the next step, to be more truly who you're called to be, to live with the passion and the gifts that you've been given, to make your own extraordinary life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and all those whom you love today, and remain with you always. Amen.